glad I figured that out before you went live.
All right. There we go. Good morning. It's good to see all of you. It's getting stranger and stranger. And I will tell you, happy Easter, first off. In my dreams, this was not how I was hoping Easter would be spent. And I know a lot of you feel that same way. We're in homes across the city and across the nation now celebrating Easter in a probably more like the very first Easter than there ever has been. And I have to think that there's got to be some excitement in that if you really think about it. And I have. I've spent a lot of time this weekend just kind of daydreaming about the days in between the crucifixion and the resurrection, and thinking people just hiding out in their homes and wondering what's going to happen next. And so here we are, hiding out in our homes, or the five or six of us that are here in the lobby of the church, hiding out from bad things that could cause us problems. I want to start by sharing some prayer requests and prayer needs. First off, Greg and Denise Marceau let us know that their daughter Kristen has come down with the COVID-19 and is at home quarantined, and they want to make sure that we're praying for her. And we'll do that here in just a moment. Kyle, if you'll remember that and pray for it here in a moment. And then I talked to John Jennings this morning also, and John's mother passed away this morning. And we were talking for just a few moments, and I reminded him that one of my favorite people at this church when I first moved here was Annie Mae Bennett, and she also shares a resurrection day with our Lord and Savior. And I don't know, maybe easier to look at it that way, but if you pass away on Easter, then that's kind of your resurrection day. So while I know John and his family are mourning, I hope that there's some comfort in knowing that his mother is no longer suffering and going through some of the things that she was dealing with. So Kyle and I are going to talk about a few things that have gone on this week, and just other thoughts and things. And one of the things I was going to ask you was about your family traditions and, mm-hmm. and things like that. What's the Bryce family been like for Easter?
Well, as you and I were talking earlier, we always go to Angie's family on Easter. And so this is actually the first Easter in maybe forever that her side of the family is not going to be all together. So,
wow.
You know, and I'm sure that's a lot of people that have very strongly founded deep traditions surrounding this holiday that are having to do things differently.
Yeah.
So that's one certainly for us, but you know, just like you mentioned, it's all about hope during this week. And we see how the apostles and the disciples, how they acted before Easter and then how they acted after Easter, two very different things.
Yes, for sure. For sure. I grew up in a home where Easter was a holiday, but it wasn't a religious holiday. We seemed to try to do everything we could to avoid Christmas and Easter and anything that made us, I don't know, heathen or whatever the thing was. So my as a child, favorite Easter memory was my mother put blue dye in our mashed potatoes for lunch. And so we got to lunchtime, and there's this nice bowl of blue mashed potatoes. And I thought it was the coolest thing ever, because as a kid, I put ketchup on my mashed potatoes. So by the end of my meal, I had green mashed potatoes. And it was, I don't know, I know that's very strange, but that's one that always just stays with me. But since then, you know, I just have a super huge appreciation for being able to set aside a day where we remember the resurrection of Jesus. I mean, I wouldn't, I don't know what the argument is, that you know, we shouldn't celebrate a day more than others, but I have a birthday and an anniversary every year that if they're not celebrated, I'm kind of irritated, right? So that's the least we can do for our Savior, I think. So I'm happy that we can celebrate Easter together. So I asked last week for you guys to send in pictures of your decorations. Thank you, Paulette, and thank you, Libby, and that's it. So the rest of you guys didn't send any pictures in. So these are some pictures from Paulette's house, and this is the best I can do trying to get them on a screen. I'm sorry I can't zoom in anymore, but in fact, I think I just messed up. Yeah, I did. Well, anyway, hopefully you can see a little bit of the picture. There we go. Bo Paulette's got an Easter tree and a cross that's really cool looking there. And this looks like an Easter bunny and an egg decorated with a cross. And then the yard sign, My Redeemer Lives. And this is out in front of, I'm assuming, Tim and Libby's new house. So they're celebrating Easter also. We did put up some decorations, but they were in the house, and our house is a wreck, so I'm not going to show you. Actually, it's not now. But there were some things there, too. So I just want to say thanks for those who sent some decorations in. Kyle, I'm going to ask you if you would just start us off in prayer and remember especially Kristen and the family of John Jennings, and then we'll go into our worship time.
Absolutely. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you in thankfulness. And across this nation, across the world, a lot of people may not be focused on thankfulness right now. With everything that is going on, a lot of people may be wondering, why us? We have more than ever to be thankful for, and we bring that to you, knowing that today is when your plan became possible. The fact that Jesus got up and left that grave, conquered death, that's what gives us hope. That's what we live for, Lord. And we cannot thank you enough for that. We ask that you're with everyone who's going through these tough times now, especially with the Marceaux's, with Kristen, who appears to have the virus now, with the Jennings family as they mourn their loss. Lord, a lot of people are struggling. Just keep your hand of comfort over everyone. You give us life, Lord. Don't ever let us forget that. You give us life, and not just the flesh and blood that we call life here, but life eternal, the true life that awaits us. Lord, we can never thank you enough. It's through your Son who rose today. It's through him we pray. Amen.
We're going to sing together, Come Worship Christ the King, Majesty, All in All. And then we'll pause a second and sing In Christ Alone and Jesus Loves Me. And then Craig will lead us in our time of communion and celebrating the risen Savior this morning. So let's sing together. And I would normally say let's stand and sing together. So in your hearts, or if you're in your living rooms, if you care to stand, that would be great. So let's sing and worship our Lord today.
Come worship Christ the King. Hallelujah. Amen. Praises to him we bring. Alleluia. Amen. With grateful heart and voice, before his throne rejoice. Praises his gracious choice. Alleluia. Amen. Alleluia. Come worship Christ the King. On high. Alleluia. Amen. Let praises fill the sky. Alleluia. Amen.
He is our guide and friend. Our lives on him depend.
His love will never end. Alleluia. Christ belong. Alleluia. Amen. Life shall not end the song. Alleluia. Amen.
On heaven's joyful shore, his glory will adore.
Singing forevermore. Alleluia. Amen. Sing alleluia. Come worship Christ the King. Hallelujah. His Majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, power, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from His throne unto His own, His anthem raise. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His Majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I see. You are my all in all. Seeking You as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless Your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, You pick me up. When I am dry, You fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, Jesus, O Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Jesus, O Lamb of God, worthy is Your name. Worthy.
Celebrate in our communion today, we'll sing In Christ Alone and Jesus Loves Me.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones He came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was. Majesty stands in victory. Sin's curse has lost its grip on me.
Corinthians 15:21 makes a reference that since death came through a man, so the resurrection comes from man. This death that it's referencing is not just any one man that just happened to die, but death that came for our soul, the death of our soul that came from the original sin that's a claim for the first man, Adam. And now we finally get to celebrate right now, which is kind of the middle act of this amazing play that we get to take part of, where Christ has now resurrected that death, the death where we lost our souls. And I think today is actually even more fascinating than we can imagine, especially for Memphis, Middle Tennessee, Arkansas area right now, because of the weather they're experiencing and the weather that's on the way for us right now. And this weather that's actually nationwide for us, because let's read the account in Matthew 28 really quick of the resurrection, and it might just come to life a little bit. In Matthew 28, now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him and the guards, they trembled, and they became like dead men. And the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who is crucified. He's not here, for he has risen." And he said, "Come, see the place where he lay." Right now, where I grew up, they're getting snow. And all the way through the south, there's lightning and thunder. And I'm sure at some points in those storms, it's thunder so loud that it's shaking buildings. Today is the day of the resurrection. It's in such splendor and such power that Christ was resurrected. And he did this for a still peace quiet of nothing and silence. The tomb is empty. And if you've ever gotten to go to the Middle East and go to Israel and go to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre or possibly the Garden Tomb, two places where different traditions say that Jesus was buried, you can rest assured that both tombs are empty. So we can know that what we stand on, this moment of power and peace, is true. This resurrection that gives us life. And also in 1 Peter 1:3, it says it gives us hope. It says, "Praise be to God, our Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he's given us a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Right now, as we take communion together, we don't just get to remember the death of Christ. We're doing this in remembrance of the life and the living hope that God gave us in this moment of power. So I'm going to pray now for both the bread and the cup so we can remember this powerful moment that it's given us a living life and a living hope. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ and Holy Spirit, thank you for the moment that you gave us the same opportunity for resurrection. You gave us an opportunity to escape death. In Christ, your power is so far above anything that we can really imagine and believe. And we thank you for this day that we get to remember it and we get to just live in it. And Father, please let this moment we remember your flesh and your blood. It is living flesh and living blood. It's not a Savior who died, but you're one who is back to life and you're still alive today. Christ, thank you so much for your sacrifice and giving us this new life that we get to live in. And thank you for our resurrection that you've provided. We ask all of this in your holy name. Amen.
Has just come to my mind this week. I posted it on Facebook. I just miss people. I miss the connection of shaking hands or hugging. I am a hugger, despite the rest of the room. But I miss people, and it's odd. It's not out of sight, out of mind. It's out of sight, and I'm out of my mind missing people. And I think about how much this church means to me personally, and closing in on half my life spent here, and I know others have got that same thing, or they've been here their whole lives, or whatever the case is. This church is just so important, and as we think about our time of offering, it's an odd thing to talk about an offering. It's an odd thing, one, for a minister to talk about the offering. It's an odd thing, two, to talk about an offering to people sitting in their homes. But this church is so important that I'm remembering a few weeks ago when the discussion was on some of our folks who've lost their income at all, and we're going to take a special collection. I couldn't wait to participate in that. And it's because the people that I know are in this church, they're my family. I don't get to be with my blood relatives hardly at all. So my family really is this church. And as you're sitting around in your home today, I hope you're missing being with each other as much as I am. And I hope the one kinetic thing that you can do with the rest of this church right now is continue offering what God's blessed you with to further what we're being allowed to do, and to continue to glorify God, to love Jesus and serve Him and share Him with this world. So let's pray and ask a blessing on this offering, and then we'll sing another couple songs. Father, I ask you just to bless and multiply what is given in your name for your honor, for what this church does and tries to do. I pray, Father, that we will always seek to honor you first with our our blessings, our financial gains, our time, everything. I pray that we will be people who set you first. And I know that we're not all the time. And sometimes, I just hope that this time away from each other helps us realize how important you really are and how important collectively we are to each other and to you. So bless this time. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing Still, and then the song that we were going to put our theme of today's assembly around, the Is He Worthy? We sang it our last Sunday together. We'll sing it again here. If you hear more voices than 10, it's because some of us recorded it this week, and I'm going to play that to help it. This song just needs to be glorious and magnificent, so I'm going to try that. We'll see how that works. But after this, Arnis will lead us in our time of a lesson, and he'll dismiss us today. So happy Easter. May God bless you, and hope you have a wonderful time with your families during this time.
Hide me now under
David's root and the Lamb of Judah.
Father truly love us,
he does.
Does the Spirit move among us,
he does.
And does Jesus our Messiah hope forever those he loves,
he does.
Does our God intend to dwell
shortly.
It's great to be with you on this Easter morning. I can't think of an Easter during my lifetime where there was a bigger need for hope, for something that would breathe life into our human spirits, because so many of us who just a couple of months ago felt like we were on pretty solid ground find ourselves in circumstances we never would have predicted. A lot of people are feeling anxious. Many have pressures or weights they didn't have. They may be regretting decisions they made or failed to make over the last couple of months or even the last dozen years, and they wonder where things will stand a year from now. You know, nobody ever wants a season of hard times or challenges to come. But when they do, they have a way of making you stand back and ask, what am I really counting on? Am I building my life on a foundation that's solid enough that circumstances beyond my control can't take it away? That's why I've been looking forward to this morning so much. Because this morning I'm reminded of the only hope capable of sustaining a human life through everything. People have not celebrated Easter Sunday for the last 2,000 years to say the stock market has risen. It's risen indeed. They've not gathered to say their jobs are secure or their favorite sports teams are doing well or they have 100 different restaurants they could choose to have dinner in tonight. Here's the one hope that has held human beings across every continent and culture together for two millennia in the face of difficult times. Times of poverty, of disease, of pain, of hardship, even of death itself. Christ is risen. People often respond back to that claim with one additional word. He has risen indeed. And I want to talk to you about that little word indeed this morning. Why do we say he is risen indeed? I've thought about that a lot. I was watching a YouTube video a few months ago where there was a bright young man saying that he believed the resurrection was not something that actually literally happened. It was more, he said, kind of a metaphor. The idea being that after Jesus died, his disciples found themselves still thinking about him and his teachings, still moved by his spirit. It was kind of like he was still alive in their memories. And that over time, the idea of resurrection kind of evolved as a symbol. This idea says essentially, we all know when you die, and that's it. So the resurrection is really just kind of a metaphor for the human spirit or for human optimism. But it didn't really happen. There's still a body in that tomb. It's a metaphor. Of course, the problem with that is that something did happen to galvanize a little group of people 2,000 years ago, and they didn't gather, they were not transformed by the idea that Christ is risen metaphorically. They did not form the world's first community to include Jew, Greek, slave, free, male, female, rich, poor, to break down every ethnic and cultural barrier based on a metaphor or a metaphorical resurrection. They did not sacrifice land, property, possessions, reputation, vocations, their lives, and positions based on a symbol. They didn't go to their death voluntarily by the thousands believing they would be resurrected metaphorically. They did it because they believed Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. It really happened. They understood all about death. They knew what it looked like. This Jesus they had followed died, and then 3 days later, the tomb was empty. And you might think at first that the body had just been moved. And at first, that's exactly what they thought. Then they said the strangest thing happened. This same Jesus began to appear to people, to responsible people, to Mary Magdalene in the garden, and to all of the disciples, and to a man who doubted, a man by the name of Thomas. Jesus came and appeared to him. And then, about 20 years after Jesus' death, the Apostle Paul wrote to a church at Corinth that after Jesus was raised from the dead, he had appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters, and Paul said, most of whom are still living. In other words, this really happened. You can go ask them. It wasn't that long ago. In terms of my life, it would have been about 3 years after we moved to Louisville. We're still friends with a lot of people at this church now that we were friends with then. So you don't write words like that unless the eyewitnesses will actually back it up. 500 saw Jesus. Paul said Jesus that after his resurrection appeared more than 500 of the brothers and sisters. One indication of how seriously they took the reality of Jesus' death and resurrection. In the Gospel of Mark, we're told that Jesus buckled under the weight of carrying the cross. And then Mark says, a certain man of Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. Now, that's an odd little sentence. Why would Mark bother to give the names of the children of the guy who helped Jesus carry his cross? Well, it was because they were alive. They were known to the audience to whom Mark was writing. He's saying, if you have questions about his death and resurrection, go ask Alexander and Rufus. See, this is not the kind of thing you do if you're writing a myth, if you're writing about a symbol. This is a different genre. This is a different kind of literature. Jesus appeared to two of his followers on the road to Emmaus, and they were so struck. They said, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us? They ran to his disciples, and they said to them, it's true, the Lord is risen. That's the phrase right there. It is true that the word indeed, that's why the word indeed is in the church's Easter greeting. It's true. It really happened. It's not a metaphor. It's not a vague hope. It's not a saccharine illusion that's given to comfort children who lost a pet or sick people who've lost their health. There's only one explanation for the accounts that accounts for the overnight transformation of an impoverished, confused, frightened little group of people into a courageous, emboldened community that would sacrifice everything, including their lives, to turn a world upside down. And that is, they actually believed this, that this Jesus, their teacher, their master, who they saw die on a cross, whose body they put in a tomb, he did what he said he would do. He is who he claimed that he was. The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. It really happened, they said. I want to tell you what that means for you and for me. For one thing, the resurrection means that now your worth does not fluctuate. Yes, the value of your 401k, the value of your IRA is down. Yes, your income has been reduced. But your worth has not even been touched. Before this coronavirus thing hit, you were worth the life of his son to God. And that's still what you're worth today. That will still be what you're worth tomorrow. I was thinking about that this week. Imagine a few days after that first Easter, the disciples James and John are talking with each other, and John were to say to James, "He's risen, the Lord is risen indeed. But my fishing business had dropped off a cliff. I feel like such a failure. I'm not sleeping well. I'm anxious. I don't know when things will turn around. It may be years before the fish ever start biting again the way they used to." And I think James would have looked at his brother and said, "Are you crazy? He is risen indeed, and you're standing here telling me you can't sleep because of how many fish you're catching? I have to tell you the truth. If he has risen indeed, who cares how the fish are biting? They're only fish. It's only money. He is risen indeed, and that means money does not get to define your identity. Money does not get to say how much you are worth. Your job, your vocation, your title, your position, how things are going up or down, does not get to say what you're worth. To paraphrase the Apostle Peter, "For you know what was paid to set you free. It was not something that could be destroyed like silver or gold. Go ahead and earn a lot of it. It's all going to be destroyed someday. It was a costly sacrifice of Christ." And some of you have been beaten down because what's happened to your job or your bank account, or even worse, the business you poured so much of yourself into, has evaporated. And whether you're to blame for it or not, it's only natural to feel taken down a notch personally by that loss. But to the God who created everything, to the God of the universe, you are worth more than every dollar, drachma, euro, peso, rupee, ruble, pound, mark, and yen ever printed. You're worth the life of God's Son, and he died on a cross, and he was resurrected, and he is risen indeed. Another thing the resurrection means for you this morning is that your future is not at risk. Whether you come down with this virus or not, no matter what happens, your future is not up for grabs. One of my favorite characters in history is Winston Churchill. And one of the things I love most about him was his sheer pugnacity. One of Churchill's mottos was, "In war, resolution. In defeat, defiance." He once gave a commencement address after World War II, after facing Hitler for a time alone. And the whole text of the address was, "Never give up, never give up, never give up." He had a famous running battle with a woman by the name of Lady Astor, a very difficult opponent. And no matter what she said, he always had a comeback for her. One time she said to him, "Mr. Churchill, if you were my husband, I'd put poison in your coffee." And his response was, "Lady Astor, if you were my wife, I'd drink it." Winston Churchill was a tough guy. But even Winston Churchill could not defeat death. When he was old man, he died. He planned his funeral. And at the end of it, after every word had been spoken, after the benediction had been pronounced, before the people left, Churchill had planned to have a bugler put high up in the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral, that fabulous edifice, and the bugler began to play taps, the universal signal that the day is done, the night has come. After taps ended, there was a moment of silence in the room, and in that silence, everybody in that vast audience thought about how this great life, and now it's done. But after the silence, there was one more song. There was another bugler on the far side of the dome that began to play Reveille, the time to get up, the song of the new day. Why did he do that? Because one man, one day, the greatest man who ever lived said, "I am the resurrection and the life." Now, Churchill was a remarkable guy. But Churchill could not say, I am the resurrection and the life. Only Jesus said that. Will your future have problems? Of course, your future will have problems. Is there a good chance that you will die eventually? There's a very good chance that you will die eventually. Does that make Jesus nervous? Not at all. Why not? He's already died. He's already taken on himself the worst that death can do, and he has risen. He has risen indeed. It really happened. Resurrection means that your past is not unforgivable. Your worth is established. Your future is not at risk. Your past, no matter what you've done, your past is not unforgivable. There was a brilliant mathematician and electrical engineer about a century ago, worked with General Electric, by the name of Charles Steinitz. He fostered the development of alternating current that made possible the expansion of the electrical power industry in the United States. Brilliant guy. According to an account in Life magazine by the son of an engineer at Ford in Dearborn, the engineer's son was named Jack B. Scott. Ford's electrical engineers couldn't solve some problems they were having with one of GE's gigantic electrical generators. So GE sent in Steinmetz. Upon arriving, Steinmetz rejected all assistance and asked only for a notebook, pencil, and cot. And according to Scott, Steinmetz listened to the generator and scribbled computations on the notepad for two straight days and nights. On the second night, he asked for a ladder, climbed up the generator, and made a chalk mark on its side. Then he told Ford's skeptical engineers to remove a plate at the mark and replace 16 windings from the fuel coil. They did, and the generator performed to perfection. Henry Ford was thrilled until he got an invoice from General Electric in the amount of $10,000. Ford balked at the figure and asked for an itemized bill. Steinmetz responded personally to Ford's request with the following: making chalk mark on generator, $1. Knowing where to make mark, $9,999. Ford paid the bill. Who do I call, though, when my life breaks down? When my marriage falls apart, or I mess up as a parent, or a parent damages your child in significant ways? You violate your values. You handle anger in a way that shames you. You get trapped in deceit. You get greedy, and it destroys your business. You get hooked on a substance or behavior that ends in humiliation. You're afraid to say something or do something that you know needs to be said, and you just feel ashamed. Who do you call? You call in Jesus. In Romans chapter 6, the Apostle Paul said, at just the right time, Romans chapter 5, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. That's you and me. And he said, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Nothing you've ever done is beyond God's ability to cleanse and forgive, because Christ, who died on the cross, is risen indeed. Some of us this morning need to hear these words. The resurrection for you means that the best is yet to come. Because when Jesus was raised from death to life on that first Easter morning, he opened a path from death to life for his followers to travel. He's our forerunner. Jesus won a great victory over sin and death for us at the cross. And now we're invited to become citizens in his eternal kingdom. Wherever you have traveled, however old you are, you have not seen the best yet. If your destiny is resurrection, the best is yet to come. Kind of a funny thing in our day. We'll talk about almost everything, but we don't like to talk about death. We don't like to think about death. We don't even like to say the word death. Life is okay. We play a game called life. We eat a cereal called life. Which made me think, can you imagine a cereal called death? There's an idea. A cereal for people who wake up really slowly. Just kidding. We buy a product called life insurance. That's kind of odd, isn't it? What do you have to do to collect that life insurance? You have to die. You don't buy it in case you live, but nobody calls it death insurance because that would be too depressing. We don't know how to handle death. Jesus does. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. That's what the resurrection can mean to you. But then, how do you get to be a part of that? How do you become a part of God's resurrection plan? If you want to follow Jesus down the trail he blazed from death to life in his eternal kingdom, then stick as close as you can to him. You respond to his love for you by loving him too. You trust him, believe in him, model yourself after him, participate in his mission, obey his commands. You clothe yourself with him in baptism. You take on his name and identity. You make a decision to wholeheartedly follow Jesus and start living for him instead of yourself. 2 Corinthians 5:15, Paul says, and he died for all that those who live no longer will live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. Now, do you do that perfectly? Of course not. But you want to. You actually take the lordship of Jesus seriously in your life because you love him. And when you love him and serve him, the Spirit goes to work on you to remake you into his likeness. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17 says, therefore, if anyone's in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. And we need to be made new so that when we get to our eternal home, it will truly feel like home. Because life with God forever will be perfect. No more violence there. No more injustice there. No more unspeakable things happening to little girls there. No more greed. No more deceit. No more arrogance. No more deception. It'll be filled with perfected people. And that's only possible because Jesus accomplished what he came to do. Hebrews 12:2 says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. What was that joy set before Jesus? It was the joy of repairing our lives, of fixing what was wrong with us, of changing our destiny from death to life. And he accomplished that. He showed us who God really was by taking on the form of a servant. He conquered death for us. He conquered sin for us. He conquered shame for us, and he's given us his righteousness. Someday he'll return. On that day, the dead in Christ will rise with immortal bodies that are a perfect fit to live in his new creation. And that is our destiny if we're in Christ. That's our Easter hope. So he is risen indeed. I thank you for joining us this morning, and I pray that you and your family are well. And the days before us, though full of trial, will also be filled with the hope of God, with the hope of the resurrection. God bless you.